Now it's my pleasure to introduce our next speaker, Peg Williams. Dr. Williams has more than 20 years of experience in high computing industry. Prior to joining Cray in 2005, she was Vice President of Database Technologies for IBM, where she managed IBM's HPC software and AIX development. Cray is a world-leading supercomputer company founded on innovation and design. Through innovation, research, and product development, Cray is recognized as a global leader in science and technology. Ms. Williams holds a PhD and master's degree in applied mathematics from Lehigh University, and a BS degree and mathematics and I'm sorry, and a BS degree in mathematics and physics, don't want to get that wrong, from Yersinius College. Please join me in welcoming Peg Williams to our conference.
All right, good morning. Tell you that those awards were impressive. I am truly impressed. So let's talk for a little bit. I'll tell you just a little bit more about me, and really what I want to focus on there is to let you know the role the teachers played in how I am, where I got to today. Then I'll talk a little bit about Cray, a little bit about our business and our workforce, and then we'll spend most of the time looking at what Cray's customers do, because that's the most important piece and most interesting piece for us. And then a little bit more about HPC, and if there's some time at the end, we'll do some Q&A as well. So, let's try that again. There we go. So we did talk about education, but you know, it's funny, when you do introductions and everyone talks about things, you always start with, where did you go to college, right? Well, I'm gonna start with where I went to school. Elementary school, and when I'm old enough, it was junior high. There was no middle school. It was junior high and high school. I'm from northeastern Pennsylvania. I was in the Wilkes-Barre area school district. And the thing that was important, you know, I was growing up in the 60s and 70s, and you don't kind of grow up as a girl at that time saying, you know, I think I want to be a PhD in math. Just doesn't start that way. But you know what happened is somewhere around, it was fifth grade, and I remember my parents coming home from a teacher conference, and they said, you know, your teacher tells us that you seem to have an aptitude for science and math, and she thinks it might be a really good idea if you thought about a career there. In fact, she thinks you ought to think about being a doctor. Didn't sound too appealing to me. My dad thought a podiatrist was a good choice. No emergencies, and I thought not so much with people's feet every day. And so we kind of move on from there, and then I had an eighth grade teacher who said, we're gonna make a mathematician out of you, and that's what I think looks like your best skill. And I thought, all right, well now he's trying to narrow things down for me, maybe this will help. The next narrowing down came when I took a biology class and I had to dissect a frog. No doctor coming from me. Could not get past that experience. Biology, that was off the plate. But then I took a chemistry class, and I really liked chemistry. I thought, oh, well, maybe this is it. So I like math, I like chemistry. Next year, it was physics. Both teachers in those spaces sort of encouraging me all the way along, saying, yep, it's a good idea. You know, you seem to have aptitudes for these things. We all agree. And they just kept encouraging me, saying, you know, it should be math or chemistry or physics, we're not sure which, but you should figure that out because that's really the direction you should go. And at the time, I wanted to be a teacher. That was my goal. So off to school I go, and I went, as you heard, I went to Yersinius College, which is a very small school just outside of Philadelphia. Maybe a few of you here from the Pennsylvania area are familiar with Yersinius. And I went in as a chemistry major because I kind of looked and said, it's easier to transfer from chemistry into either math or physics than it is if you start in the others and go into chemistry. So we'll start there. And similar to biology, we got into experiments and we were doing things and I was kind of all thumbs in the lab. Thought, it's probably not a good career choice. So that's how I ended up with a bachelor's in math and physics from Yersinius College, the process of elimination. After that, though, I came out and I got my teaching certificate. I did my student teaching. I was all primed and ready to go and teach. But I had taken a couple of computer programming courses. Now, again, I told you, I'm old enough that when I was in school, there weren't, if any, computer science programs. So the math department typically got stuck with teaching programming classes. And when I finished, I was looking for jobs in the suburban Philadelphia area, and the teaching jobs were a little harder to find, but programmer jobs were everywhere. So I ended up programming for a while, and I did that for a couple of years until I had a coworker convince me that I should go back to graduate school, that that would be a good idea. I was actually working as a contract programmer at DuPont, and one of the women I worked with had a husband who was a PhD chemist, and she said, you know, I've watched him in his career. He doesn't really need a PhD for a lot of stuff he does, but he wouldn't get the jobs he's in if he didn't have one. So you ought to go back to graduate school. Okay, one more piece of advice. So I did. I went to Lehigh University. I still stayed in the greater Pennsylvania, greater Philadelphia area, a little bit further out now up at Lehigh. And as you heard, I had a master's in math. And then the summer after I got my master's and before I started my PhD, I did an internship, a summer internship, at the Oak Ridge National Laboratory, and I was introduced to supercomputers. And so this now is in the mid-80s. Supercomputing was making a move. You'll see in the next chart when I talk about Cray, things sort of started rolling in the 70s a bit. But while I was at Oak Ridge, I had access to their supercomputers, and I did get access to this thing called a Cray XMP, a supercomputer at the Lawrence Livermore National Lab, and I was hooked. I liked what I did. I liked supercomputing. So I finished up at Lehigh, and then went to work first time out at IBM. IBM was building supercomputers at the time. They were hiring, and this is where this advice that my friend gave me who sent me back to school, IBM was only hiring PhDs at the time. Now, the job I had, you didn't need a PhD to do, really. But they were only hiring PhDs at the time. So I did that, and I had a number of jobs, management jobs at IBM. And then I got a phone call in my office one day, and the person talked to me for a while, and they said, we have this job opportunity we want you to consider. I said, uh-huh. I said, so I listened to about a half hour of it, and I said, can you go back to the beginning again? Where did you say this job was? Maui. I'm thinking, at the time, I'm in Kingston, New York. Now, it was summer. If it were winter, it would have been a much easier decision, right? And I said, Maui. They said, it's only a three-year kind of thing. They're starting up a new supercomputer there. They're looking for some folks who understand supercomputing. They want folks to work and train the users how to use the supercomputers. I thought, oh, wow, this sounds kind of interesting. So off I went to Maui for 3 years. And then at the end of 3 years, I had the option to stay and decided, no, I'd go back to IBM. So I did at the time. And that was one of those times when the hiring manager called me up on the phone, and she knew me from when I had worked at IBM before. She said, you know, Peg, I know you have the offer and everything, but I'm thinking you might not be smart enough to hire. And I said, oh, really? She said, yeah, you're willing to move from Maui to Poughkeepsie, New York in January. Maybe that's not such a good idea. So needless to say, I did go back, and I worked for IBM for a number of years. Eventually was transferred to Austin, Texas, which is where I live now. And then a couple of years later, I got a phone call from someone that had worked at IBM that had moved on and said, you know, Peg, I'm taking over as the president at Cray, and I really need someone to manage the R&D team. And I thought about it for a while, and I said, you know, I'm going to do supercomputing. It's in my blood. While I was at IBM, I diverted from it for a little bit. You heard in the introduction, I was managing database stuff for a little while. And I was going from, and you'll see some of the examples of our customers, but I was going from working with a customer at IBM who was simulating nuclear explosions, as they said, from button to boom, to listening to a customer, JCPenney, complain because the SHU report didn't run. I couldn't connect with the SHU report. I didn't kind of care. And I knew that supercomputing was where I needed to be. So when the offer came from Cray, that's where I went and that's where I've been. So I just wanted to give you a little bit of a flavor in the background here. But I will tell you, there's absolutely no way that I would be where I was without starting with that fifth grade teacher and that eighth grade teacher and that chemistry teacher and that physics teacher every step along the way, encouraging me that I could do it and it would be a good thing to do. So let's talk about Cray just for a little bit. The company itself was founded by Seymour Cray in 1972, and before that there really wasn't much supercomputing. Seymour was previously at CDC doing some work there, but and it was all about faster computation. Now, of course, the power of those first supercomputers are probably in your cell phone. In fact, your cell phone's faster than those first supercomputers were, but they were pretty impressive at the time. And we've got, focused on the bottom, we've got seven development sites. The two largest are here in Chippewa Falls, Wisconsin, and the other biggest one is in St. Paul, Minnesota. So here in the Midwest, that's where the company, Cray Research, was originally founded. And I guess I'm in Wisconsin, so my Wisconsin folks tell me that you know you're not from Wisconsin if you say Chippewa, and if you're from here, you say Chippewa. So I'm in Wisconsin, so the Wisconsinites are laughing, so I think I have it right. So we've got over 1,000 employees. Cray has been up and down. At one time, the company was over 7,000. It's been down into the hundreds, and now we're up over 1,000 again. Our purpose, and this is what excites our employees every day, this is what we talk about all the time, it's building computational tools that help change the world. We don't change it, but the tools we build in the hands of the right people make a difference. And that's what keeps the workforce engaged every day going in. And when they start to get discouraged, we show them some of the things I'm going to show you in a little bit, because that's what excites them about what we do. In the introduction you heard, R&D really drives our business model. At the core of everything we do is R&D innovation. We spend a higher percentage of our profits in innovation and R&D than any other technology company. It's where we focus. We've applied that innovation predominantly into high-end supercomputers. However, we've branched out a bit now. We also build clusters, storage. We do things we call custom engineering when a customer wants something like what you have, but just a little bit different, and we do things like that, and now data analytics. So let's start with, so what is a supercomputer? I'm just going to take you through some of the pieces and parts to give you a feel. How many of you have actually seen a supercomputer at some point? Okay, cool. So for the rest of you, I'll kind of give you a flavor of where we are here. So we start with a little piece. We call that a processor daughter card ourselves, but two processors and memory associated with those processors, and a card that's about, we didn't do show and tell because it's kind of tough getting this stuff through the airports these days, but, about that big. And then we put them in cabinets. What we do is that little thing sticking out, that's one of our boards, and it has eight of those processor daughter cards on those boards. So, and you slide those boards into those cabinets. Those cabinets are about the size of a refrigerator, maybe a little bit taller. And so inside those cabinets, there are 384 processors. Then we take them, that's an actual picture, I don't know if you can see it in the back. We take two of those cabinets, put them together, and then every processor gets a wire to every other processor. So that's the cable maze that sits in the back. I always look at that and go, gee, the service guys must have a fun time when they have to repair, because it's it's kind of fun to go back in. And then we take those two cabinet groups and we connect them overhead with fiber together to build out systems that are bigger and bigger. And we'll talk about, I'll show you some of the sizes of some of the systems as we go. And so that, put it all together, make it look kind of fancy, put cool doors on it. One of the things we let our customers do is design their own doors. So they give us a graphic, we put that graphic across their computer, so you'll see some pictures of our machine with different things. And the way that looks, you see there's a skinny cabinet, and then there's two wider ones, and then there's the skinny one. Those skinny ones are cooling cabinets, so that they're cabinets full of fans. And air comes in through the side, gets cooled, goes through the compute cabinets, and every two, there's another cooling cabinet to keep that running. That's your little lesson in terms of what do they look like and how big are they? I get that question a lot, so we'll just kind of take. So think about that, 384 processors per cabinet. You will see in some of these, some of our larger systems have over 175 cabinets. They're monsters. And those in those customers who have them, they're not using those processors individually, they're taking an application and running it across the whole machine or some significant subset of that machine. So our vision right now is about supercomputing, and it's about what we call big and fast data. But we talk about sort of modeling the world. There are problems that can't be solved, the grand challenge problems. They're the ones that we focus on, the big ones. And historically, it's all been about mathematical models, right? Where you have a physical phenomenon. My favorite is the weather, right? There's physics that governs the way the weather moves. Can't solve those equations in closed form. We do numerical approximations of those. We use computers to help with those approximations. And then it generates a bunch of data. That's sort of traditional supercomputing in the math models that it works with. But there's more and more things coming about. Okay, if it'll work when I click, there we go, I have to click harder, where we're starting to see data models emerge. Now, think about, a good example there is, think about all the data that gets generated with Twitter and Facebook and Instagram and all the social media and all of the work people are doing to mine that data to figure out trends and what should we be doing. And so you're starting to see more and more data models emerge, and really what you're seeing is the fusion of the two. And I have to click harder. And we could sort of call that data-intensive processing. There's a lot of mathematical models generating a lot of data, and then there's a lot of real data feeding back into the mathematical models, and you see it across the space. So to be successful, we really focus on the ability to compute, the ability to store, and the ability to analyze all of that data. Number of technologies, one of the most important ones. Remember I said they have all those processors, 384 per cabinet, and all those cabinets connected by all those wires. Something has to make them work as an entity together. And that's the system interconnect. It's one of the sort of the special sauce that our engineers provide is the interconnect and then the software to manage it. Just think about what it would take to apply a patch to the operating system on a machine that size with all those, right? Some of the software magic sauce that goes on top, as well as what we call the programming models, the tools that allow someone to actually program this as an entity. And then the packaging, the cooling, as I showed you, sort of those blower cabinets and all of that sort of stuff. And we put it in a package where there are lots of different processors out there. Intel processors, NVIDIA GPU processors, a lot of different processor types, and we actually let you mix and match inside the system. And so we do see this convergence of big data and supercomputing, and I said it's being driven a lot with all the social media data, the weather models, and we just, as I said, we see this fusion coming between big data and big compute. And so what does that mean, kind of going forward? Well, all of these things are coming together. There's data-driven science, there's traditional things like the computation with complex models, and the theoretical research and the numerical work, all kind of converging, all data sources being used to produce results. And the idea here is there's an awful lot of data available, either generated or available. And out of that data, how do you get insight? How do you get real information as opposed to just data? So I'm going to skip this one and go to the next one because I don't want to run out of time as we talk about the jobs of today and tomorrow, and because I really want to get to the customer stuff because it's kind of cool. But something that you're hearing more and more about is the data scientist is becoming more and more of a commodity as you look at it. And so there are a couple of examples here. I always love the way we write the one on the furthest left of the government, right? Where you want to discover a new plot by someone to do something. Clearly, a lot of social media data goes into that, as well as other data sources. And I really don't want to know what they are. Insurance, so fraudulent claims from online providers. You can see a couple of them as you go through. Or, we'll talk a little bit about it later if I don't run out of time, the sports one. Surprisingly enough, there's actually somebody doing this, right? An optimal hitter lineup against division rivals. Baseball is known for its data. Anybody remember the movie Moneyball? Well, this is Moneyball, the sequel, as we have. And ESPN just put an article out, and they were going through, you know, who uses data analytics in all of the sports. And they kind of went through all of them, and they said, we're not allowed to say who the team is, right? That's part of the confidentiality agreement. You'll see that on some of these others. We have a lot of customers. I put up a list that say undisclosed, undisclosed, undisclosed. And so ESPN went through this whole article, and they said, and so based on this, we think it's the Houston Astros that have a Cray. And the only thing that we've said is, guess again. So it's kind of fun to watch. You know, it's sort of an interesting example. But it's, again, you've got a lot of data. How are you going to take that data and create information that's meaningful, that you can do something with? And more jobs, right? Simulation scientists, software engineering, hardware engineering, manufacturing, and manufacturing engineers, the people who figure out the materials that you need to build this stuff out of. Product management, market, even in supply chain management, where you've got to figure out, and you have to figure out, you know, who do you buy your parts from? Dell is the world's best at supply chain optimization. When you're building high-end supercomputers, you got to be a little fussier about your suppliers and where they come from and what they produce. Our workforce, just to give you a feel, you can see the most common degrees, not a surprise, computer science, electrical engineering, mathematics. The schools that we recruit from, but the larger percentages of our employees are from, not surprising since the bulk of the employees in R&D are either in Chippewa Falls or St. Paul, that the big schools, you know, Minnesota and Wisconsin and several of the different campuses, not just the main campuses of those schools, and the Chippewa Valley Technical College as well. Just to give you a flavor now, we certainly have students from, you know, all across the country and from various things, but that's where the highest percentage of our workforce comes from. All right, try it one more time. Our challenges. So we joke around about Chippewa. We do have a hard time recruiting into a more rural location of Chippewa. Chippewa has about 10,000 people. Eau Claire is nearby. It's got about 50,000 people. Anybody know why we're in Wisconsin? Anyone know why we're, you could say, well, why are you in Chippewa Falls? Anybody know? Leinenkugels, that's a good one. Seymour Cray was born in Chippewa Falls. And when he started the company, he moved the R&D team to Chippewa Falls, Wisconsin. And in that day and age, supercomputing was so hot, people would move from anywhere to get a chance to work with Seymour. And so it was not a problem. As we move on, it's harder and harder in those kinds of locations. And then we have on-site staff that sit at a lot of our customer locations, and some of them are not in such swell places either. Right now we're doing, it's public. We're doing a little staffing in Saudi Arabia. Try and get someone from the U.S. to go there, or even try to find someone over there to work on supercomputers. It's a challenge either way. Certain types of jobs, libraries, math libraries, storage engineers, hardware and software architecture. Why? A lot of the kids that go into computer science think it's cool to write in Java or higher level languages, or they want to work for Google or Amazon or Microsoft. And the core technology that you need to build a system, it's harder to recruit those kids into that type of work. And then finally, the women in R&D, so it's hard enough to recruit. Of the workforce that we've got, you know, 12-ish percent are women in R&D. Interestingly enough, 29% of the managers are women. So it's kind of a little, once they're in, they end up, you know, doing pretty well in the management roles. Future hiring challenges, you folks probably know this. This is from a STEM article, but it scares me to death. It basically says that between 2008 and 2018, we'll see an increase in demand, forecast increase in demand for hardware and software architecture, those things I have a hard time recruiting for, of 45%. A lot of my workforce started and were around in the early days with Seymour. They're getting ready to retire, and the demand is, it keeps increasing for those skill sets. It's a challenge for all of us. Who are trying to hire into these types of fields. Okay, with that, I'm going to switch to customers, because as I said, what really gets us excited is the work that customers do with our machines. So here's a laundry list. I'm not going to go through all of those, but you can see a broad range. It may be hard to see in the back. I apologize for that. I didn't realize, and it's a good thing, that how large a group we were going to have and how big the room would be to project. But we have a lot of weather centers. They're the ones on the left. They say Earth Sciences, they're weather centers. And then government, education. So education are things like NSF-funded machines here in the U.S. and their equivalents in other countries or specific universities. Life sciences, energy. And this is now, the further you go to the right, the more commercial the customers become and the more undisclosed that you start to see. So there's some more in energy, think oil, manufacturing, and then financial services. And those guys, not a single one of them is, you know, they won't talk at all. They all think they have something really unique and very, very different from what everybody, they're all doing the same thing. It's just variants of it. And those variants, though, you know, they tell us, you know, a nanosecond difference in a trade makes a difference. So it is important, those differences. So let's talk a little bit about some of the customers. Let's first, okay, Ronnie, get ready. We got a video coming up next. I have to cue them back there. It'll be fun. The U.S. Department of Energy, different pieces of that, and their strategic priorities. Innovation, so innovation in basic science, right? In energy, finding clean energy for us to use. And in security, which is guarding the nuclear stockpile. This is a machine, this machine is called Jaguar, and the research I'm showing you is from Jaguar. This machine has subsequently been upgraded to an even larger supercomputer, but you can get it, that's an accurate rendering of the actual size of that machine. It covers the size of this room. Easily with supercomputer. So some of the research, hard to read, and I apologize again, but here, an engineering company, BMI, was using Jaguar, looking at overhaul long-haul trucks. What they're trying to do is save on fuel bills. It's the biggest expense they have. Their trucks travel lots of miles. Any little bit that they can get in the efficiency of the fuel saves them a ton of money. They were using that machine to take a look at that. And if you see that sort of white hump thing under the truck, that's one of the things they're now starting to install in all their trucks, because they're estimating about a 7 to 12% improvement in fuel usage and fuel efficiency by mounting those at the bottom of the truck and changing the airflow around the truck, reducing some of the drag around the truck so that they get better fuel efficiency. That's, you know, so it's sort of an energy kind of example. Also doing some work in genome sequencing, and here, you know, you see the commercial, I forget which one it is on TV, I think it's one of the insurance commercials where they have the guy and they said, you're not somebody that's sort of like you, I think he's going to get insurance and they're trying to figure it out and say, well, you know, just because you have a certain demographic and you're similar to someone doesn't mean you're them. And the genome sequencing is all about understanding from a medical perspective you and what impacts you may have. And here they're doing some work to try and get the testing down to a more reasonable cost so that you could actually apply some of the knowledge they have, trying to get it down under $1,000 so that you, it's a test that could actually be done, and looking to do work in the cancer project as a result of being able to get costs to a reasonable level to do that. And then finally, and I'm just giving you sort of a range of examples across here. One of the other things they're doing is, this is a big data problem, looking for child pornographers. They have a customer that at the lab who's actually, and that's all about looking at the data patterns and looking at the usage patterns and the grabbing files from the internet and kind of searching the space, mining all of the data about access to interesting sites to try and find the predators in that space. NERSC is another one of the machines. It's another Department of Energy machine. That machine that you're seeing there is Edison, is the name of that machine, actually. They name all of their machines after scientists. So Edison was up for this one. Again, basic science. I'm going to actually skip this one. I'm going to go to this next one. And I'm not going to talk about it. We're going to show you a video about this one, too. This one you'll see in the bottom, it was one of the physics world's top 10 breakthroughs in 2013. And they tell me we should watch this space because they think there's a Nobel Prize in the future coming for this researcher. So what the scientists are doing, I can talk about the Max Planck stuff here, is what they're looking at is, you know, from the Big Bang till now, there's a whole bunch of atmospheric sort of background, cosmic background. And what they're trying to do is figure out where the background is so that they can, as they do experiments and things, they can take the background out of the equation to understand what's really happening now. Because there's so much background. How do you separate out the stuff that's happening now from the stuff that happened from so long ago and kind of get that and be able to filter the background out? So it's pretty fascinating. If we ever get the video, we can see it. And by the way, I'll give you links to all of this so you can see those. Blue Waters, this is, I think, the largest machine that we have. This is the really big one that's sitting down in Illinois at the university in Urbana-Champaign. 13.2 petaflops. So you've got megaflops, which are millions of floating point operations per second. That's sort of how you measure the speed of supercomputers. How many ads can you do in a second, right? So million floating points, and then we had gigaflops, and so they were the billions. And then we had teraflops. And now we have petaflops. So you just keep going. 13 petaflops. So 13 quadrillion, I think, floating point operations per second. Yeah. It easily fills the room, too. Impressive machine. They built a building just for the machine, so it's got its own big building sitting on the campus. Just some examples from there. One of these is an earthquake simulation, right? Simulating what's going on and trying to get more precise simulations, earthquake simulations of what's happening in California. Why do you want to do that? Because you want to protect. If there's something coming, you want to know if you best you can where it's going to happen. You're looking to, it's about loss of life. And you'll see that in some of the other weather examples as well. And there it is. This is the Hurricane Sandy simulation that was done. So just to get a feel now, there's a number of others in here. What I'd like to do, there's one video that I really want you to see. There's the sports one that we talked about. And I want to come to the end here because I'm hoping we're going to skip the conclusion because I want to go to this one. If we can find it. If you actually, I don't know how to click on Big Red, but if you click on Big Red, the video should play directly from there if the internet's up. Big Red is a machine at the Indiana University.
With me as a technical person, of course I'm excited about feeds and speeds and accelerators and processors, but at the end of the day, it's the capacity, it's the ability for Big Red 2 to enable our researchers from disciplines from medicine and engineering to physics and astronomy to make those life-changing discoveries or enable those life-changing discoveries for not only Hoosiers, but for people all around the world.
The advantage that we'll see with Big Red 2 is up to, we calculate, about a 25-fold increase in throughput. So, for example, an analysis of human genome alignment that would take 197 days, we now project to complete in 8 days.
Supercomputers like Big Red 2 enable us to do simulation and modeling at scales that are not possible if we try to study things directly. So this can help in things like disaster management or maybe crop management, so you can understand from a bigger picture what's happening to the ground below you.
We would like to turn solar energy, carbon dioxide, and water into fossil fuels. And so this is a technology that will provide a solution to the energy crisis that we have currently. And with the new supercomputer coming online, we're very excited because we can now not only carry out our research more efficiently, but we can now do calculations that we were dreaming about doing that we couldn't do because the computers weren't just fast enough.
Always have a hard time. I could almost not talk at the end of that. That was done by obviously Indiana University for their supercomputer, but it really sort of embodies and said, you know, with my staff we talk about building computational tools to change the world, and nothing captures it better than that particular video. As I said, we'll have those available if you want to use those at any point. They're all out on YouTube to take a look at. But that's supercomputing, and that's kind of what we do, and what, more importantly, what some of our end users do with these machines to make big changes. So thank you.